government adopting blockchain. Shocked. Let's have a look.
Namaste everyone, मैं हूँ सभी भारी आकाश तिवारी and with me we have Neil Kevin Martis and Shesha Vishnu Prasad. So you guys are founder of LegitDoc. Okay, CEO, CTO.
LegitDoc is a blockchain standard built on, currently we support both permissioned as well as permissionless blockchain. Using this standard, any document issuer, for example, a government department or a university or a bank, hospital, anyone can issue tamper-proof digital documents to their stakeholders, which are completely owned by the stakeholders. And these documents can be verified from anywhere around the world within a matter of 10 seconds. Basically, we provide a blockchain-based registry whereby any document issuer will be able to issue registry of any of his documents on the blockchain, which are made tamper-proof, which are rendered tamper-proof, and can be verified from anywhere around the world. And once you give this ability, right, you can build a lot of services on top of it. So basically, we are trying to achieve two things. One is remove the problem of forgery that is existing in India or across the world. Especially across the world, there is no, you know, innate or go-to protocol using which you can issue tamper-proof digital documents, which are verifiable, free of cost, within 10 seconds, right? That is one. And secondly, recently, you might have heard of this big Web3, Web2, you know, people talk about Web3. See, majority of our issuers or majority of the systems work in Web2. And you kind of need to provide a bridge between Web2 to Web3, right? So which is a completely different dimension. So we are trying to be that layer who kind, you know, integrate the Web2 to Web3, kind of give that integration or give that kind of a bridge. So that was briefly about this. You talked about your university certificate, right? So currently how it is working, your university will generate a certificate, paper certificate, they give it to you, you own it. Let's say you go to an employer or anybody, right? And you need to give this certificate to him. And later he'll, you know, call up the university or through some mechanical or manual means he'll verify it. Now, using LegitDoc, we kind of give this interface to the university. In addition to your certificate or maybe in parallel, you'll get a equivalent digital certificates, whose something called as digital fingerprint has been put onto the blockchain. So you actually get your certificate, digital certificates, which is powered by Ethereum or whatever kind of blockchain, and you own this certificate. There is no portal where you go and download this. Something similar to your physical certificate, you own this digital certificate. You know, you can own it on your phone, you can have it in your cloud, you can share it with them. So the moment you have a digital certificate, you can share it as simple as sending a WhatsApp image, right? And let's say there is a verifier or somebody you want to, with whom you want to share the certificate, he'll get the certificate only if you give it to him. So basically you're the owner of the certificate. And apart from this, there is an open source verification portal, which we maintain a copy of, and we always encourage the issuers to, you know, maintain a copy of the verification portal on their website because they shouldn't be dependent on us. And this portal will directly talk with the registry that has done on the blockchain. Now, let's say there is a verifier or employer, and you have given this certificate to him. All the employer has to do is go and drag and drop or upload these digital certificates on the verification portal, and voila, within 10 seconds, you'll get to know whether it's tamper-proof or not. So basically, your documents are not stored on any cloud place where somebody could go and access them or maybe even hack them. So the documents are with you, but the proof of these documents are put onto the blockchain. And there is a kind of a verification portal where we can, you know, can verify the certificate. And let's say you give the certificate to somebody, they'll be able to verify it by a simple drag and drop or upload mechanism. That's how it works.
Okay, dokie. Obviously, I've seen like it takes actually 30 days for a normal verification of a document. Now you guys are doing it in 10 seconds. Approximately, it used to take 1100 people. Now it takes just 4 to 5 people overall, like from dispatching to managing and everything. So you guys have actually like reduced it more than half, like half se bhi zyada you guys have done it, and kudos to you guys. But like what I want to ask you is, like, how is this different from block certs, like except for the private ID and key? Like, what is it different from block certs? Because when I was researching about block certs, I saw that there are 3 major teams in India divided in south, south, west and east. So block certs are also working with it. Obviously you guys did it first in India and you guys have already tied up with government, so that is a very good thing. But like, do you think, like, is it going to be different or is it going to be a competition for you guys?
See, first of all, block certs was the one who started this revolution, right? In 2017, I think, if I'm not wrong, there was this concept of, you know, issuing, having a decentralized registry on side chains of Bitcoin early on, where, like, going back to 2015 or something like that. But a practical implementation of the same was started by block certs, and even they are our inspiration to start this. And again, you mentioned that, you know, they have their own ID or something. It's really great, right? So I can't take that away from them. They have done something really great. But again, we kind of got inspired by this idea. That is great. And why did we could have copied the entire thing, right? We didn't do that. We kind of made it in the Indian way. Why did we do that? For example, you see how the block cert system is. It's really working. And probably they have their own app. you can store your certificate using your certificate IDs. You can store the certificates, and if you want to, you know, share this certificate with somebody, you kind of share that URL with them, a JSON some URL file with them, and you give it, right? So now you think about India, a developing country like India, or any other developing or, you know, underdeveloped countries. First of all, they are just coming up. People are getting speed with this, you know, digital revolution. What we personally believe is that you cannot expect people to, you know, think about IDs, holding IDs. And let's say I want to give my certificate to you. See, I want to see my certificate, right? I can't just share one URL with the it may be working really good for the developed part of the world, not for India. It should be simple. It should be an extension of what we are currently doing. What are we doing currently? You just get a hard copy certificate, which basically is a printed form of PDF, and you give this to somebody, right? People are used to seeing this, you know, certificate or something. So we kind of wanted to give this experience. At the back end, how our system works and how our block search system, it's kind of same. Like everyone is doing the same. And even there is a new project called as Open Search done by Government of Singapore. Kudos to them. They also work on similar principle, right? I mean, nothing innovative, nothing out of the set. But what we try to give is, say, instead of, you know, having these IDs or your UX should be very simple, right? In our case, the students of Maharashtra are getting a simple PDF, a copy of their marks cards, right? In a zip format, a zip file, as well as a PDF file of the marks card, as well as something called as blockchain certificates. Everyone in India, at least, are used to PDFs, right? Sharing PDFs, sharing zip files. You can open zip files using your normal phone or something like that. You don't need to worry about your any certificate URL or ID. So we kind of gave this kind of experience. Basically, our UX is completely different compared to block search, whereby, let's say you're a student, you will receive a simple zip file called legitdoc.zip file, which consists of two parts. One is the original certificate issued by the issuer. We do not even need him to change his existing systems in place, right? And his format or something. Whatever the certificate that is currently printing, the same certificate, a digital copy of it is given. And there will be something called as blockchain-based key file, which again, I can share with you. Probably you can have a look at it, which again looks like one more PDF. As I said, the UX is very important, right? People are used to PDFs. People are used to sharing PDFs or zip files or weaving zip files. So we have kind of gone with the simplistic approach where you do not need to worry about, you know, any URLs or IDs or something like that. It's very simple.
See, I think Kevin, as Kevin pointed out, right, there are two things to this. Number one being, as Kevin said, block certs, you know, for a country like United States, where you can expect most of the people being digitally educated, or they at least know how to use digital tools and technologies, right? In countries like United States, you can introduce a solution where you can expect people to hold their digital certificates in an application or in a wallet also under their credentials. But in countries like India, especially if you consider the use case of MSBSD or in most of the use cases, the end consumers who are going to hold the certificate. In case of Maharashtra, skill development, it was people who attended the skill trainings, right? And you can't expect those people to to be digitally equipped or to understand how to use such a system, how to hold those documents, or when someone asks for it, how to provide them with those documents, those login and stuff and so on. And to understand what's happening over there, why am I even handling this system? See, there are these kinds of nuances that the person must be digitally educated to hold these documents. So where we you know, bring something in this space is, we only expect them to hold a simple document, just like they hold a simple PDF or something. We don't expect them to hold any login credential to access these documents. We just mail to them. And as you pointed out, in Maharashtra's use case, we are providing the document as a download only because we didn't have the email IDs of the previous registered students. And our main concern here is, we have a lot of advantages, but our main concern is, number one, transparency, number two, privacy. There are a lot of use cases where, you know, privacy becomes very important, and our solution, our document issuing solution, is also very much transparent and privacy centric. For use cases like hospital bills, you don't want the patient's medical history to be out. I mean, if I'm storing it at some place, there is possibility that server or centralized place might be compromised, then my patient's history is also compromised, right? And similar is the case for bank documents as well. If someone comes to know your bank balance and then your Aadhaar card is also compromised, and then they know, they come to know about your address, they know you're pretty rich, and then you're gonna get robbed or something.
Yeah,
so privacy is really important.
Wrecked is the new word, right? Among the millennials.
Yeah,
right.
Wrecked is a new word.
Yeah. Oh man, you guys are active on Twitter and Reddit, I think so. But what I want to ask you is, you guys collaborated with government, Maharashtra government, Okay. What were the things you kept in mind, or what are the things one should keep in mind while collaborating with such people? What were the difficulties? Because obviously, one good thing is, one amazing thing is that someone from the government is supporting you guys. Okay, you guys are collaborating with the Maharashtra government at this stage is actually amazing, because a lot of government spokesperson and people are actually on in the middle grounds, right? They are not taking any stand. They are not going around blockchain and crypto. They are not going around non-blockchain, non-crypto side. They are just like, okay, we'll wait. And at this stage, someone like a Maharashtra government has taken, because usually we have this wrong image about governments, ki yaar, country ka kuch nahi hone wala, ye government aisa hai. Koi bhi government ho, ye aisa hi hai, right? But someone like a Maharashtra government did something and they actually took a first step, which is amazing. But what were the problems actually faced by you guys? What are the things you kept in mind?
We started this as a part-time thing somewhere in 2018. We were working in a different sector. Obviously, we just came out of college, can't afford to, quit your job and do it. And we kind of did it part-time for 2.5 years, and simultaneously, we were trying this. And we were, if you critically see about ourselves, we were a B2B company, right? Business to B, blockchain company. And there are WazirX, all these kind of exchanges fall into the B2C consumers. Especially in 2017-18, regulatory clarity was not there. In fact, forget about clarity. People were telling we are going to ban it. And RBI had even banned
you. Yeah, in 2017.
They didn't ban cryptocurrencies as well. But exchanges, at least banks, were not allowed to deal with anybody who is giving crypto services, and primarily exchanges. So that a bad environment was created. Now, at least in the B2, I know that, especially Nishal Shetty has gone through a lot of difficulty, and kudos to him. Whatever we are today is, I wouldn't be wrong to say that Nishal Shetty is one of the single-handedly has taken this entire tribe there, and kudos to him. And but if you critical thing again, they were operating in a B2C sector, right? Where consumers, even though some of them are worried about how the regulation will be, people like me or millennials like you will get into it because there is not a government influence. But when you talk about B2B businesses, right? Businesses are always wary about regulation. No one wants to try a solution. And because of the philosophies we had, see, there are two blockchain verticals that we can call. One is permission blockchains, like Hyperledger Fabric or something like that, and permissionless blockchain. And obviously, both have their application, but it's like intranets versus internet, right? For example, internet is the place where every application will be built. And intranet has this very limited applications. I'm not saying that it's worthless, but it has some applications. But majority of the innovation lies in internet. Why? Because it is open source. People from anywhere around the world can copy their code and develop new things, so and so. You can draw the same parallel to cryptos as well, right? At least we saw that majority of these applications should be built on, or are most ideally are to be built or candidate are permissionless blockchain, like Ethereum or now recently Polygon or Solana or something like that. And we can get into that later. So we wanted to do on permissionless blockchain, right? And first of all, since this the clarity was not there, people were talking about blockchains, but nothing was substantial was happening in blockchains. Okay, there are two people now as our end customers. One is the government, one is the corporate side. Corporates were telling, hey, blockchain is good. They were giving up a lot of white papers. But give me an example where, one corporate has successfully integrated blockchain into that. Going 2 years back, right? So
I think so. IBM and Shell, but those are not Indian companies, right?
Yeah, those are permission blockchains.
Yeah, permission, not permissionless. Yeah,
yeah. I'm talking about permissionless space. Operating. Yeah, permission blockchains. Yes, IBM has come up with his own, Fabric, or somebody else have done a lot of permission blockchain. Again, this is my personal opinion. I'm not a true believer in permission blockchains. It is the same
intranet
technology with a different hood. And yeah, we are also building something on permission blockchains. I mean, it shouldn't be hypocrisy on my side. We are also building something from permission blockchain space, but the use cases are very limited and very specific. So there was no one who was, kind of building, permissionless blockchain protocols or apps in India, at least, right? And governments were kind of talking about it. So we tried going to a lot of private players, and they said, okay, your technology is really good. As you know, Indian mentality, like, has anybody else done it? If they have done it, you show me and then I'll do it. So this was the roadblock we face each and everywhere, right? Then, okay, we were like, okay, this is not working out. Then we started kind of reading that, a lot of state governments, especially more than central government, were talking about blockchains. For example, Telangana, they wanted to come up with their own blockchain policy. Maharashtra was talking about something, we'll do POCs and all. Then we thought, okay, we should probably go and prove ourselves with the government domain. Then once you have a project, the way people see you will be completely different, right? So we thought, okay, we'll go to government side. So that is kind of decided. Now, one more problem is we are a startup. We don't have a lot of money. We do not have a lot of reputation. Why in the hell any government will come and work with you? right? And probably even if government does something, they were thinking of, you know, collaborating with Wipros, IBMs, and those people will be selling them the, again, permission the blockchain shit there, right? No, nothing about permissionless blockchain. So, and even if we do kind of system, we have to go through the tender route, so which we do not have. So then what we did was, I don't know whether it's intentional or this luck matters, right? We started going out and start participating in all the competitions, government competitions or private competitions. So there we started winning a lot of competition. We kind of got our visibility, right? For example, I still remember in 2019 or something like that, the first competition that we won was called Government Mentorship Program by Government of Telangana, where they had selected 10 startups across India who was working in emerging technologies. So that was the kind of first platform that gave us a record. Now we could go, hey, we have been selected by Government of Telangana, you should consider us seriously. And we started winning a lot of other competitions as well. Elevate, like we got a seed, you know, grant of rupees 30 lakh rupees from Government of Karnataka, which is again a really good initiative by Government of Karnataka. A lot of in IIT, they have a competition called 10 Minute Millions. We started winning all this competition. But the tides turned when we, so there is a unique competition called as Maharashtra Startup Week Challenge. Recently they finished one more cohort where Government of Maharashtra every year conducts this program and selects 24 startups across 12 different verticals such as e-governance, like mobility and whatnot, right? I mean, municipality, education and all that. And in each sector, they'll select two startups. And through this competition, we were selected as one of the two startups selected in e-governance field. And the beauty of this competition is that for the first time in India, hey, here is a government who not only gives you mentorship, they'll give you a direct work order without any kind of background, without any kind of requirement, direct work order without a tender. So this was kind of a, you know, game changer for us. And obviously we faced a lot of difficulties because see, even though we have got a work order, then there was a difficulty of finding the user department, right? And usually user government bubbles don't know any, first about, forget about cryptos, they don't know about anything about blockchains. You need to, you know, talk about them, then all these state departments are running their legacy systems, they're pretty old systems, how to integrate. So a lot of challenges were there. And we were, so probably we, you know, once we won the competition, probably it took more than 1 year for us to, you know, find a user department that was suited to our need. But at least with government, I should give kudos to Government of Maharashtra. See, I have, again, taking a step back, maybe I'm going out of the line. I have interacted with a lot of government officials in Kerala, Karnataka, Telangana, even I think few more government AP as well. The kind of you know, environment that is there in Maharashtra is unbelievable. So we have probably gone to a lot of departments, heads of department, because of this competition. And maybe they didn't understand any of the stuff we were telling, right? But one thing they were telling, hey, we should try this without even thinking back, because one, the Maharashtra State Innovation Society had vetted this project and these people did not need to shell out any money from them. Their side, because the government of Maharashtra has itself has earmarked some fund for us. But whatever it is, right? The kind of approach that I found in Maharashtra was like amazing. And probably if somebody is wanting to try out new solutions, I think Maharashtra government should be the place where you should try this out. Anyway, so luckily, maybe something like a God gift, 1 year down the line, we met somebody called as Dr. Anil Jadhav, who luckily is a technocrat. He doesn't come from regular, he's not a regular government babu. He comes from tech, he's an engineer by profession. He has worked in IT field and he had a lateral entry to this. And he had very good background in securities. He knew about cryptos. He knew about cryptos, what the regulation was. So we met this guy. Again, this is all, you know, events, I could call it lucky or something. So we met him there and we explained, he's like, this is amazing. We should do it. Why aren't anybody else doing this? And we kind of gave an example of, for example, what BlockCert has done or what OpenCert has done. So we kind of gave this narrative where the, you know, governments like Singapore, Bahrain, Malta, they're coming up with their own standards for digital warrants. Why shouldn't Maharashtra come up with its own standard, right? And this could be the first step. And he immediately liked it. And I did not need to go and explaining what a hash is, how a blockchain, because he knew each and everything, right? And immediately he took it up. And traditionally, how this, you know, these work orders work is, they work on a 1 year pilot basis. So these are usually taken as pilot projects. But he told, no, hey, I do not want to do a pilot. Let us go for a full-scale implementation. We should be doing this for 8 academic years, previous 5 academic years and next coming upcoming 3 academic years. So these series of events turned out to be very lucky for us. Then we implemented it. And even during implementation, we had a lot of challenges. Like, for example, again, if I'm not going out of line. So as you know, legacy system, especially government departments, have a very old system. And when we were trying to tap or integrate a solution with this Maharashtra department, we found that, hey, they are running some local database, which cannot be even run with Windows 10. You have to have Windows Vista software in your PC to run this database. So that kind of challenges we face initially, all right? But we could come up with a turnaround. We had a bridge crawler software to bridge this. We kind of finally, within a matter of 2 months, we were able to do this. And we got a lot of support from the department and department staff as well. kudos to them, and even kudos to Maharashtra, State Innovation Society. And we kind of implemented where nearly we have issued somewhere around 1 million education certificates, first of its kind in India. It would be not wrong to say that even though there are open certs, block certs, it is the largest implementation in the world for education credentialing. Right? So that's how our journey has planned out. And after that, once that Maharashtra news came out, especially on Cointelegraph, it has been a life changer for us right now. Because of that, see, we were the same team, the same concept before, but just because of this recognition or this, we were the first one to do it, or kind even among this regularity, even though clarity was not there. Now people are coming to us, giving us deal, like talk about it, because they're not completely official without their permission. Like, but a lot of deals are coming. A lot of governments are looking. We are doing something, two more projects in government of Maharashtra, something we are doing in with government of Telangana. These are just government sites. Apart from that, there are a lot of even one of the sister institutions of UN, United Nations, are looking to work with us because of this kind of platform we got. So that was really amazing. I wouldn't say that it was just some, genius from our side. It was due to persistent, hustle plus a lot of luck. You require a lot of luck in startups. Yeah. And we found the right guys at the right place. Yeah.
Bro, my mind is blown that people from government were pro about it and they were actually fast to adapt it. Like, ye circle mein ghum jata tum log ka project. And there would have been a lot of major players who would have actually, thrown you out of the circle and they would have capitalized it. But because in government, these things happen, like people have this notion ki itna time lagta hai. But my mind is blown actually. Because when I was watching your 25 minute Legit Doc video where you were trying to teach them how to put it on the MS, Maharashtra Skill Development's site, I actually saw your training video. I thought that you would be having very difficult time. Like, people wouldn't be that interested in learning. But like, I had a very wrong image, ki basically unko seekhna pad raha hai, theek hai? Something like that, and they are not pro to it because I saw just one person asking you one question. I didn't see any interaction there, okay? But now after hearing this, I am like, wow, like, okay. I had no idea ki someone is so pro and adapting and supporting. I think so, India actually realized it ki they lost the internet war, like being first. So actually they don't want to lose on this. And that's the reason they are not taking it lightly. Obviously, you got, there was few hard lucks in other governments, but some government actually took it. So this is a good thing. It's a good thing.
Yeah, see, I'm not trying to hype about Maharashtra because they gave us a project and, I want to impress them. I'm just telling my experience, right? At least from what I have felt, I don't know about others. The government of Maharashtra is in a different universe altogether, especially for startups right now. One major driver would be the Maharashtra State Innovation Society, which is kind of, see, as you told, if you go to a government department, they'll, unless you go from top-down approach, they'll, make you go circles, and there are a lot of people you have to get, and you know how it works, right? Here, what has happened is, since they have passed the legislation, and there is a separate department in Maharashtra government called Maharashtra State Innovation Society, which is kind of driving from their side. See, again, if I can take one more minute of yours, or one to two more minute of yours, I'll tell how it is completely different. First of all, there is a dedicated wing called as Maharashtra State Innovation Society. Once you have won this competition, you are assigned one dedicated manager from their side, who has come from private sector previously, who will, even if you don't follow up, he'll follow up on your stead, that he'll make you connect, he'll come with you, he'll try to. So that's why this speed is there. And secondly, it is headed by an IAS officer called as Kushwa sir, who is very visionary. Dipendra Singh Kushwa, who is very visionary IAS officer. Our first interaction with him, we were kind of surprised, right? Because I had this other experience. I go to, other departments, they're like, okay, come karza hai, whether it'll work, or, okay, we'll see, we'll talk to this guy or that guy. We went to Kushwa sir. Probably he's not even from, before meeting, Jadhav sir, our first meeting was with Kushwa sir, because he's the CEO of MSINs. When we went to him, and our MSINs manager who was assigned to us called Sijo Varghese, was really, really great, amazing person. And he has helped us a lot there. He took us to Kushwa sir. And Kushwa sir told us, sir, bhai, mereko blockchain ke bare mein kuch bhi nahi pata hai. Give me a presentation. And we kind of gave a presentation to them. Contrary to our experiences, probably he didn't even, maybe he understood the entire part of it, but maybe he just understood 50 part of it. He didn't ask us, his first question was not, whether it's going to work or not. Like, how can we try this? So that is the approach that we have found with Maharashtra, where whatever departments we have gone to. So I think if you are starting up somewhere, and especially if you are in a very new domain where not a lot of regulatory clarity is there, Maharashtra Startup Week Challenge or Maharashtra is the first place you should start with. Yeah.
So, how do you get into these competitions, Maharashtra Startup Week, or like how do you enroll yourself? Like, are there some prerequisites? What are the requirements?
Yeah. See, for example, there are a lot of competitions. Like every state, for example, if I have to talk about Maharashtra State Innovation Society's that Startup Week Challenge, every year recently they just concluded it. It's an open challenge. So whereby they give out an open application that startups from across India can apply for this. And there are some limits, like your turnover shouldn't be more than 25 crores, which most of the cases it is not, but basic requirements, right? You should be a DIPP startup or something like that. You could just apply and they will ask you to, you know, define the problem statement, what your solution is, submit a basic PPT or something like that. And I think with respect to this competition, every year, they receive somewhere around more than 1,000 to 1,500 applications. They have an dedicated team. They'll go through all these applications and shortlist 100 startups out of all these. It's an open process. Once these 100 startups are selected, then you have kind of a closed meeting presentation in Mumbai. You go there. I think this time it was remote, but for us it was in person thing. So these 100 startups went and pitched there, and some expert jury will be there, coming from government expertise or private domain or something like that. And they'll select 24 startups. That's how it is going with the government of Maharashtra. And for example, in government of Karnataka has a very innovative this thing called Elevate. Elevate 100, they call it now. Whereby, can you believe, government of Karnataka funds near up to 50 lakh rupees free of equity for just your idea, to turn your idea into a product. The caveat is you should be a Karnataka-based startup. So even now they have the thing is live now. One of the application is live. So this is there are a lot of open competitions. For example, in Telangana, there are competitions like, government mentorship program. Again, it's open competition to everyone. There's a very unique program called as Lab 32, done by T-Hub, which we were part of the fourth. And T-Hub is also, again, amazing place. But from Maharashtra, I think second place where you should start your journey would be T-Hub. I have had very, very good experience there. They're well connected with the government side. So probably you can enroll. If you're a startup from Telangana, you can easily enroll yourself at T-Hub. Or for a startup who is not from Telangana, a good point of, to entering the ecosystem would be programs like Lab 32 or something like that. Yeah.
Damn, man. Mind blown. So what I want to ask you is, like, obviously a lot of other startups, dApps and everyone, they have tokens, tokenomics and all going on, right? They earn through that. How do you guys are going to earn? Because there's an open source thing on Ethereum you guys are tying up with. It's B2B solution, right? So, like, how do you guys are planning to generate revenue? Like, what is the, like, model, business model?
Yeah, basically, we are generating revenue. I'll talk about the model which is working for us, right? First of all, as you told, for crypto-based startups or dApps, or especially crypto protocols, you can kind of fund the entire operation into tokens. We could have gone for our own tokens. Again, there are a lot of scams in this space. And especially for a lot of dApps, right, you don't need token. That is the hakikat we tell, right? And there are genuine startups or protocols for which you need a token, inherent token. But I would say for 99% of the project, you do not need a token. It's just a get rich quick scheme. We didn't want to do that, right? And that was, so we do not have, currently we do not have a token for developing new protocols in the future. Maybe we are thinking of going for a social token protocol later on, maybe down the year. So that aside, see, here what we are doing is all these B2B customers, let's say governments or universities or banks, let me take a step back, right? So if you want to interact with Web3 or any blockchain protocols or permissionless blockchain protocol, you need a token. You need to have some kind of token to interact with it. So when you say token, you need to have a wallet. When you say wallet, you need to have a private key. These people do not want to deal with all this shit, all right? So what we did was we kind of abstract this layer. So we have a mechanism where they have control, we have control. But we kind of abstract this layer of, they just pay us in rupees. For example, in case of Maharashtra or government, a classical thing will be the issuer pays us per document this much in rupees. We kind of hold the smart contract at the back end. We take care of the gas fees. We kind of abstract that layer. And for end user in this use case, there is no fee, because verification or reading data from a blockchain is a free activity as long as you run a full node or you have services like Infura or something like that. So verifying these certificates is free, of course, any number of times. So what we are trying to give is the self-verifiability should be the property of the certificate, right? Because once you do that, you can build a lot of services on top. Now people are talking about social tokens. How can you get to a point of social tokens? Let me talk about that later. I'm going all over the places now. But what we were doing is we have kind of abstracted that, the Web3 layer away from these people. We kind of maintain it and they pay us in rupees. and we kind of take care of the gas charges. That's how it's working.
So you guys take care of the gas fees and everything. Like, you are the one interacting with the Web3. These guys are just interacting with you guys. Like, you guys are kind of like an API through.
Like AWS service, right? See, you don't know what is happening behind the hood. It's just you pay him in rupees or dollars. Forget about it.
Got it.
Service, because what we believe is that if you again see this space, right, this token based model has worked really great, especially for tokens or DeFi protocols, but it is in B2C space. You're not, have you seen any adoption that has happened in B2B space with tokens? It's very rare, I would say. I don't know. At least in India, it is not there. Maybe across the world, it is happening. So because this concept is very complex to people, right? Coming from Web2 domain. So we understand that maybe 5 to 10 years down the line, our entire world will be tokenized and people will be familiar with it, right? At least not now. So that is a problem we are kind of solving right now, providing this bridge. And over the period of time, people will be, you know, comfortable with the fact of handling their own blockchain private keys, handling their own funds, especially in the B2B sector. But at least now we don't see that happening. So we are kind of giving that bridge as a service provider.
Latter part you said, like, eventually people will be having their own private keys, even their own private wallet, right? How are you going to transition to that? So when I was asking you the BlockCerts question, right, I didn't mean to compare you both, right? I'm just saying BlockCerts are directly, like, they are way too out of the reach right now because they require a private wallet and all. Something like Maharashtra Skill Development, whatever people you are interacting with, like a government bodies, they don't have that much infrastructure, and not of the people don't have even people around me don't have a private wallet, right?
Digital awareness is not there.
But eventually we are going to lead to that, right? Yeah. So are you guys also going to transition to there, or what are you guys, are you guys going to still stay here? Because people will, if I have some documents, or if I have anything verification or any document related thing, I would be wanting it to stay in my wallet and not like, you know, it being issued as a PDF from a site or something like that.
Yeah, first of all, just to clarify, right, we are not in control even now, even though I am saying that, you know, we are kind of maintaining the smart contract, we are not in control of the documentation. Even let's say Shesha or me wanted to call it, I'll not be able to do shit. That kind of design it is. So I'll explain you how it is working currently, right? So let us take an example of government of Maharashtra. So how it's working there. So we have kind of a app. Abstraction form. We have an API, but abstraction. So for government of Maharashtra, we gave a simple desktop app, which they're comfortable with. It's running on their PC. This app has a unique mechanism. So have you, generated any Bitcoin private keys on your own, on like bitcoin.org or have you?
Right now, I have created a MetaMask wallet. I have bought some Bitcoin, ETH and a lot of other tokens, and I have like just taken the first step of transferring it there now.
Okay, great.
Like, to MetaMask.
So, you open a MetaMask wallet, suddenly you get a private key, right? They say that it is randomly generated, and it is randomly generated, but you don't get a feel of it. So if you want to get a feel of it, I think the address is bitaddress.org, something like that, or just type that, you know, generate a Bitcoin paper wallet. Okay, go to that any website that you give, and there is a mechanism to generate a randomized private public key pair. So whereby using your mouse clicks or your keyboard strokes, you create a source of randomization or error, and you create a random private public key pairs, right? So basically what is happening is we give this software to them, and they generate a randomized private public key pair generated by them, all right? And they generate private key, which you understand, using which you can sign something. Public key is using something you can verify something, right? So we generate, again, I'll not get into the tech part of it, but they generate a private key, public key. They keep the private key with them. We do not have any access to it, all right? So it is embedded into the software format, or even we can have a hardware wallet. We make them go through a mechanism whereby they have a lot of backups of these private keys. So basically they generate one private key, and they kind of give the public key to us, and their information like mail ID, the hash of the password, and so, right? Other information, public information will be given to us. So this is one part, right? And second part is coming to the blockchain layer. So there is a blockchain smart contract in case of Ethereum. Currently, it is deployed on Ethereum. And
so right now, Maharashtra government has a desktop app. They have the private key. They give you the public key and all the other information access required. Jo, it's normal everywhere. It's required.
Yeah.
Okay. For every person, or just for the for every person, you get a public key.
No.
Or it's just one.
For the Maharashtra board, you get. So he is the issuer,
okay,
right?
He
generates for an issuer. There's a single private key that he's generating.
Got it.
So
got
let us
it.
Take this in one silo, right? So let us have it in one silo. On the second silo, there's a blockchain layer. So let me come back to the first silo later on. So on the blockchain layer, if I dumb it down, so there is a smart contract, right? a smart contract again will have a private key and a public key. Using the private key, you can generate something called a smart contract addresses. You can generate any number of smart contract addresses. So it depends on the code that you have written. You can deploy the same code. I mean, I'll not get into technical. So there's something called as nonce, a different nonce there. But basically, with using a private key, you can have different addresses or smart contract addresses. Or I would say that these are different siloed codes you can create on Ethereum. So we have one private key using which we make a contract. All right. So basically, in this case, it's a simple Excel. It could be, you have worked with the tables, right? So it's a simple. There are two tables on the smart contract. First table says that. What is the issuer name? Again, it is not how it is working, dumbing it down. On the first table, there is something called as public key versus issuer name. So the public key that is there in that, right? It is nothing but the public key that the Maharashtra government is providing me. Basically, his digital signature. So his public key versus, for example, Maharashtra State Board of Skill Development will be put on one table. So there is a next table. So let me take a step back. Now, as I told you, there is a smart contract layer, right? For which private key and public key is there. I maintain that private key because I need to pay the gas. I need to fund that, right? So I maintain this private public key on the smart contract. The Maharashtra maintains one private and public key on his app for digital signatures of these documents, right? Because I shouldn't be a proxy to who is issuing this. Now, this setup is there, right? And now what is happening is I have given this app. So let me go back to the first silo now. I have given this app to this guy and he'll generate. So what government of Maharashtra used to do and every issuer, they have some kind of dumb database server, right? On which the student, for example, let's for student certificates. The student certificate data is there. And using this database, they always generate PDFs, blank PDFs. And once you generate PDFs, you print it on a piece of paper. We do not require them to change any of their process. Let them do it as possible. So what we did was we gave them an app and on a single folder, as per their convenience, they are generating these PDFs as usual. And later they can print it also. What our app does is, again, they log in and all that. There are lots of that layer. Basically, our app will calculate the standalone app. When I say standalone app, it is working on his PC. My backend doesn't have any control to it. It is just one-way communication. It will calculate something called hash. You're aware of it, right? Hashes of documents, which are, as you know, it is unique to each document and irreversible in nature. So basically, it will calculate something called as hash. Let's say there are in a batch, there are 1 lakh documents. It will get 1 lakh hashes. Then it will send all these hashes, signed hashes. So basically, he'll sign these hashes using that private key. First private key, which I do not have any control of. These signed hashes are given to my backend, hashes plus signatures. Then I do some kind of something called as compression, called as Merkle tree operation. And I, let's say there are 1 lakh hashes, I compress that into a single hash. And that hash, I put it onto the blockchain on a second table. And I verify, I have told that this hash is signed by this guy, right? My smart contract will verify whether this is valid against the public key. So I will make sure that, so basically on the smart contract, I will put that this final Merkle root or final hash is put by Maharashtra government. How do I authenticate that? Because I have his public key put onto the smart contract, apart from the smart contract public key. Once this final hash is there, our software will again generate something called as blockchain proof. I'll not get into the technical part of it. Basically, it will have, so once you put some data onto the blockchain will return some transaction data. Track your transaction on the blockchain if you need to. Then apart from that, we generate something called as Merkle proofs, some kind of proofs which will help to uniquely identify the individual document hashes with the final hash, so called Merkle proofs. This and the blockchain transactions, we'll combine it and make something called as proof file or key file, and we will attach it with the individual PDF documents. Right? Now, these original PDF documents plus this blockchain proof are called as digital documents. Nothing but PDFs, again, digital documents. These documents are output to the issuer or the department. He gets it on his desktop, indexed as per the roll number or whatever, however he wants. Then now using a simple mail API or even downloadable format, he can send this digital documents to the issuer or to the students, right? Now students will not have any private keys or something like that. You just draw parallel to what is happening. Currently also students are getting some, hard copy printed by the authority, right? Same, they're getting hard copy, soft copies of the same thing. Now, but the advantage being, there is one more verification layer which is running on the board website, which is directly pointing to that smart contract without even our backend involvement. And if anybody drags and drop uploads this certificate there, so basically what it will do, it will separate the document, it will separate the proof, it will hash the document, it will combine it with the proof and check whether that is there in blockchain. And if you have done any kind of, you have changed even one dot in the document, its hash will change, the resulting hash is not there on the blockchain. Done. do every student need to worry about his private key? No. Is it in line with what the existing student is doing? Yes. So without any kind of experience, you know, having domain expertise, you are just a student. You are getting some PDFs which are used to. You can have it on your phone and dragging and drop without having to worry about public keys, wallets, and all that. You are getting this kind of experience done. So that's why we call it as the Indian way, the Jugaad way of doing it.
And that too in 10 seconds.
Yes.
Yeah. Fuck, bro. Amazing.
Yeah.
Amazing. I loved it. I loved the way you explained. Thank you so much. It was amazing. Babari.
So even though we are maintaining the blockchain, so we are purposefully maintaining the blockchain keys because we do not want the issuer to deal with these kind of private keys or ether gases or something like that. But without their private keys, even we'll not be able to issue any documents in their name, right? And for verification, it is not going through my portal. It is going through their portal itself. So they are actually pointing to the smart contract, which is to be. So even if there is a colluder from my department, my company, right? Some influenced employee or something like that. Even he'll not be able to do anything. So because everything is in the control of issuer now, I do not have any kind of control. And if you see, even go to a next step, if you analyze this situation completely, is there any document that is there online or even in my backend, do I have any documents in place? Nothing. What is there with my backend? I have some randomized hashes. What is there on the blockchain? Some, there's, Merkle proof, Merkle root, which looks like a pair of gibberish. Let's say my backend is hacked or somebody wants to go and hack something, right? What is there? Is there any problem for privacy? All they'll see is some hashes. So your original documents are there with the issuer. And beauty of the system is even without having to have your original documents online, without even having to expose your documents online by keeping it offline, you can give this entire digital experience. Yeah.
Got it. So now, again, just taking this concept of digital certificates, right? Just your graduation certificates, you can apply it to your hospital file information. Just take a random example. So I had this idea, maybe I thought, like when I was trying to search about LegitDoc, na mere dimag mein aisa khwab aane lage ki okay, I'll be collaborating with LegitDoc on this project and stuff. I was like dreaming about such stuff, theek hai? So I had this idea of passport verification. Mm-hmm. So tell me if I'm right, if I'm wrong, and if this is a good business venture, let's do a meeting. Let's do this. But I'm serious. I don't know if I'm right or wrong. Let's talk about passport verification, right? So in passport verification, there are a lot of things you need to do. And recently, when I was learning about blockchain, coincidentally, I also had to verify my passport, right? So you need to first fill the forms. Okay, then you need to go to the passport guy, passport office. You need to verify their everything. Then someone from the police department, from the passport, a police officer comes to your house. They verify it again. Then you need to go again to the police station. You need to verify your documents there. Now, after 10, 15 or 20 days, the passport is going to come here now. Okay, now suppose if we apply LegitDoc, what are the things which can be saved? What are the things which can be do, and how much time it can be saved? Like, what are the things we can do?
Yeah, for example, are you talking about a use case where you're trying to apply for the passport here right now?
Right now, I'm renewing my passport. Passport. I already have a passport.
Oh.
For the renewal also, I need to do so much of verification. Nothing has changed. Not my address. Nothing has changed.
It's simple, right? For in this case, I give this LegitDoc interface or a modified version of LegitDoc interface to the passport issuing authority. So instead of, in addition to you having a physical passport, you have a something called as digital passport. And you can make it such that you can append it. You can design a lot of stuff. But at a very crux line, you have a digital passport, which anybody will, and there will be an API run by the passport agency where anybody can come and verify this entire passport or the entire history with a simple drag and drop, right? So you need not go to any government office or somebody, not because see, your passport is already issued by them. The entire, the trail of your background check is already done. So you can give this kind of experience with this. And since you get in the blockchain layer, right? And since passport is very, very important document, see, advantage with, doing these kind of verifications on blockchains or public blockchains rather than the traditional digital solution is now you can actually go and see the entire verification logic, how it is happening.
Exactly.
Yeah, it is not only open source, it is something called Balaji Srinivasan has coined it is called open state and open execution. You can see the entire code running, the verification logic that is running, and you can be guaranteed of this thing, right? So you can do this. So this entire difficulty of going through this can be done within 10 seconds. You go through a equivalent something like LegitDoc. And you need not stop here, right? For example, let's talk about education certificate. Oh, this in case. Passport office probably can do a digital equivalent like through simple digital signatures or something equivalent of, you know, DigiLocker maybe, right? But what happens again, there is a closed system. If I have to build something on top of it, I need to ask their permission. Now, let's say you have this registry on blockchain, which is, again, you understand open source, open state. You can even read data from it. If you run, you know, send some APIs, you can't write data to it, but you can read data from it. Now you have you are a 13-year-old kid. You have an innovative idea that, okay, if this guy has American passport, let's just for think, just simplicity's sake, that you have Indian passport with certain credential, so much of travel history or maybe something, right? Some kind of service. And I'm able to verify that on the blockchain. I can go and build one more layer, because now I don't need permission of passport department, one more service on top of it. If this passport crosses certain criteria, he'll be able to apply for something else. A classical example would be, let's say think about the education, you know, certificates right now, right? And you can apply for a lot of things. Even Balaji Srinivasan recently, have you read about in January there was a huge debate that, you know, at least an article that India is going to table a bill to ban cryptocurrencies. During that time, Balaji Srinivasan came up with a very beautiful article, set of articles. In one of the articles, he talked about a concept of how can using cryptos, we can, you know, address the problem of MSME funding crunch of $300 billion. I'll get back to it, but let me take a step back. Right now, take an example of education certificates. Now, let's say you do it by legit docker or equivalent open permissionless blockchain method. Now, you kind of have an ability where every student will be able to prove his track record on chain. Now, have you heard of a phenomenon called as social tokens, whereby, you know, people can spin their own tokens and fund their own things? Now, think that I'm a student of IIT, right? And IIT, or actually I'm a student of NIT Suratkal, one of the top NITs, not in par with IITs, obviously. Let's think that I am an NIT student and I can prove for 4 years that I have done really well. It's on my marks, right? And I can prove it on chain now because of this ability. Now, what I can do is, since it is open source and open state, I can come and build one more, you know, probably something called as, I mean, I'm just throwing idea around because this is open source nature. And, you know, in open source and open state nature, people come and build stuff. You can build a social layer protocol there where, let's say I can put up my profile and my entire history of Marx cards and where I'm from. And you know that crypto has very risky investors, right? There's a large capital pool. And I can spin off my own social tokens, create something called as creator tokens. And now if I can prove my social graph on chain, so there will be some people who are ready to take that bet and fund your studies, fund your experiments or something.
Something like a BitCloud?
No, BitCloud is a different... Yeah, BitCloud is a different...
Stuff. Like betting on people, like not...
Exactly. Huh. Yeah, it's like, see, if you want to take loans, what you do? You give something like a collateral, right? So in traditional sense, let's say one student has to fund his MS. What do? You give a collateral or some bank guarantee or some this thing. So there is a new concept of social tokens without having to have an actual collateral. You give them something called a social collateral. Based on your social profile, you go and, you know, raise funds. Now, for example, tomorrow, Naval Ravikant, right? Or Balaji Srinivasan. Let's say tomorrow Naval Ravikant came and told, I'm going to launch my own tokens and you can come and buy this token. And for the next 5 years, I'll be able to do some project. And all the dividends on this project, 50% of it, I'm going to give it to the token holders. Without any collateral, you will go and buy this coin. Why? Because you know that Naval Ravikant has a social profile. But Naval's social profile is tied to a platform such as Twitter or something, third parties, right? So now there's one more very amazing phenomenon happening called as social tokens, whereby on chain, you'll be able to prove your kind of entire track record. So if you critically think about this, your entire education credential is there on the blockchain right now. I mean, the provability of the entire credential is there on the blockchain. And let's say that you are a very good student who can prove on-chain or your track record. And since it is entirely open source and open state, now people can come and build new services where, you know, people will be able to spin off their own tokens. And if I say that, hey, I have scored, you know, so-and-so about 99 in all my 6 semesters. And I have this so-and-so, I'm from NIT Suratkal. And let's say I am generating my own tokens, come and fund my studies. And after maybe 5 years, I'll give you this, you know, my dividends of my salaries. So you can come up with such, this is just one example. So many kind of such innovation. Now, let us, again, if I'm not going out of way. So have you read the paper by Balaji Srinivasan that was discussed in, I think, released in February or March?
Not yet.
Okay, great. No, not a problem. So he has, you know, explained in detail. So there, again, let me take a step back. There was a huge debate, you know, why should India need cryptos, right? Apart from speculation, why should India need cryptos? What is the use? So regulators or RBI governors were asking this. So he kind of explained in detail, you know, how India will benefit by building some protocols around it or some applications and these social tokens being one of it. And one of the classical examples that he had thrown around, see, in India, MSMEs are, you know, that after next to agriculture, they're one of the highest, you know, employee, you know, have the highest number of employees, right? They're the bread givers in India. And you'll be surprised to hear that there is a $300 billion funding crunch for MSMEs. So this was again published by Balaji Srinivasan. And your traditional banks are not able to fulfill this because these people do not have traditional collaterals. So you need to post some collateral or something like that, right? So to get some kind of loans. Again, this is not my idea. This is, I think this idea was done by Balaji Srinivasan, as well as there is a team called iSpirits, who is behind the India Stack. India Stack, you have heard, right? For example, UPI, DigiLocker, all Aadhaar, all this come under India Stack initiative. And there's a voluntary group called as iSpirits, who is kind of, you know, driving. So they had come up with this paper and kind of Balaji Srinivasan seconded this. So now think about this. Now there's a funding crunch of $300 billion. Our traditional banks are not able to fund it because their MSMEs need to show some kind of physical collaterals, which they do not have, because of that way, that's why they're not getting this fund. Instead of this, there is something called as GST portal, right? Where since last 5 years, these people are, you know, kind of filing their entire GST returns. So the entire track record of these documents is there with GSTN, correct? Which is again a closed system. Now, why don't you give a API, for example, LegitDoc API, right? Or equivalent API, whereby once you do all this, so if you have worked with the GST portal, basically what you do every month, you collect all your invoices and you submit it to the GST portal. They kind of, I don't know how it works, but finally you get a statement that, okay, this is for your current month, this is your GST return, or this is your total turnover. So this, let's say you get a blockchain layer, and let's say through LegitDoc API itself, this final output is given. And the vendor is able to get now a blockchain certificate of given by the government, right? Now is your entire 5 years of track record is provable on blockchain, on open source blockchain. Now you can go and build a social, you know, kind of social infrastructure. Even we have plans of doing this down the years. Let's see how it goes. Where, you know, any MSMEs can come and register themselves using the regular APIs, their, you know, GSTN numbers and all that. They can upload all these, you know, blockchain certificates, give or blockchain invoices or whatever the returns of their 5 year historical returns, and set up a profile. And there is a, let's say there is a one click button to generate their own tokens, and it has some kind of commitment in 5 years, they are going to give so much a profit. Now let's say I am a risky crypto investor. I knew that crypto, at least crypto space, is $2 trillion industry now. It's more than $2 trillion. There's a huge capital available, right, which is planning to go to some space, and people are investing on things like Dogecoins. This is meme coins and all that. We are living in that era. Now you give this kind
going
of
to the moon.
You give this kind of infrastructure whereby on chain you are able to see the last five year track record of one industry, right? Maybe you get an incentive, okay, let me just, you know, go and buy some of his tokens. So you will get exposure to his entire business. And if talking from MSME point of view, even without having a physical collateral, just by having a social collateral, he'll be able to raise funds, right? So this is the beauty of where blockchains can come in. And like, for example, people like LegitDoc, who kind of give this integration between Web2 and Web3, can make this happen. So blockchains can
it's something like doing a fundamental and technical analysis of a stock through those papers, and all like a person can do, and then they can obviously bet, or bet is the wrong word, invest
in it, yeah.
on that thing, yeah. So it's like the traditional, the stock market and the social thing is gonna like blend in some unique way. It's still happening. It's not done till now, but it's blending. It's still blending now. And we like, it's just an idea, but yeah. So basically, I think so Cardano is, you know, integrating with the Ethiopian government. Mm-hmm. Obviously, you said ki Singapore mein ho chuka hai, Bahrain mein ho chuka hai. We are actually the fourth in the entire world to do this. Amazing
For education certificates,
yeah, and now I think so I've heard say Cardano is doing with Ethiopian government. So obviously we are at a very good speed, right? We are at a very good stage, and now you guys are also expanding more than India, like baki jagah pe we are also trying it, right? And you're trying it in different sectors. Okay, so people have still not transitioned to DigiLocker yet. Like, okay, I haven't transitioned to DigiLocker, and I'm not planning to do it. Like, I'm planning to directly transition to LegitDoc, because someone like me who's already exposed to crypto will not go through this, right? Yeah. And obviously, as your CTO has also hacked DigiLocker, okay, and DigiLocker is this centralized thing where it can get hacked, it can be, you know, a lot of things can happen to DigiLocker, right? Is LegitDoc going to, because as countries are planning CBDC, Right. Do you think like in future they can also plan to, you know, because you're a B2B solution provider and in you're integrated with a lot of people, do you think there's a risk that government will somewhere down the line block it or will cut it down and they'll try to build their own solution around it? Do you think about that?
Again, it's an open-ended question. You can't take away what's going to happen in the private sector. So maybe see, with government-sponsored documents, maybe they'll be able to do it. For example, let's say for public universities, right? So they might enforce it. Hey, you don't go with DigiLocker, LegitDoc. You go with our new blockchain system. That's possible. That's not enforceable for private documents. And there are a lot of private documents. So I do not see that as a threat. And you know how government machinery is there, right? It's going to be, so we are going to beat them on the tech for the next 5 years. I'm really sure about it. See, if you just see, DigiLocker, we're talking about DigiLocker is a really great initiative, right? Because in India, the digital literacy is very less. And maybe DigiLocker is the right first step for people to onboard to a digital platform, because people were, you know, carrying physical certificates. If you do not have digital literacy, DigiLocker is the right step. And Government of India has done an excellent job. Even NAD is a really good step. But let's say you are millennials who know this stuff, right? For example, what is DigiLocker? Basically, it's a centralized repository where you store all these documents. You have some kind of secure APIs. Through these secure APIs, you expose for document verification and access, right? You find one vulnerability in the API, everything goes haywire. So that's why you cannot have your private documents or some your medical histories and all cannot be put in on a system like DigiLocker because of obvious reasons. So next evolution of this will be blockchain-based documents where your documents are not there per se in a repository or something like that, right? So these are in siloed with the issuers offline and you kind of own it. Maybe there is an equivalent app where you can store it and you can make multiple backups. So basically there will not be a central point of failure. At least till now, what I've seen with Government of India is, I do not know for what reasons, maybe they're talking with the wrong guys or the kind of literacy that is there. Governments are gravitating more towards permissionless blockchain.
Exactly. That's my question, because they are more open to permission and they will be transitioning there. So I think that's one thing.
Yeah. So, and see, it's like this. If you, again, I think I was born in 1994. You were maybe later after me. So when were you born?
98, dude.
Okay, 98. You're 4 years, you know, younger to me. Anyway, so we were not in the internet era, but what we have at least read is when this internet came, right? So this concept was very foreign to people. People lost their shit. Hey, this is something unheard of. Why should we let everyone to publish everything, right? So if you see again the same trajectory, the governments and few established corporates were the first one to go and implement intranets and, you know, talk against internets, right? But where did the final innovation or where did the future protocols? That's on the internet because of the open source innovation. I think same is, and I might be wrong, but same history is repeating here. Like governments or top corporates are gravitating more toward permission blockchains. But eventually they have to come around here.
Yeah, exactly. Obviously, I agree with you and the same trajectory is going on. But I just wanted to ask you the same thing because it's a contractual based thing, right? After the contract, there are chances that they would be, gravitating towards them, maybe creating their own permission blockchain, storing them and stuff. Things can happen that way as well, right? This is the more optimistic way and which is a good way, but it can happen the other side also. So have you ever thought about it?
Yeah, government is not my primary customers and I'm not trying to get into the government sector because you know what is the reason, right? Government was my first stepping stone because at least in India, if you've done something with the government, people, you know, look you through a different lens. Then see, obviously as a startup, why are we here? We are here to make money, right? At the end, apart from making the impact, where is the money and where is the faster decision? This is the private sector. That's where we are going right now. So government sector, if we get some opportunities, definitely we are open to it. But our entire focus is toward the private sector. There are various applications that we are running now. See, I don't think even if, you know, this worst case scenario where government comes up, I don't think it'd be a huge impact for us because that is not the primary sector we are kind of targeting. That was just a stepping stone for us to come up here.
Got it. But yeah, it's a good thing because if you have that thing, you have access to a lot of the millennials who would be interacting with the government, who would be interacting with the university. And of course, every year we like send lots and lots people in trucks and planes to US and other countries. They need to verify their documents every time. There's a lot of things. Like, of course, there's one of the reasons, like I'll be applying to university abroad, they need to verify the document. It can be done through LegitDoc as well, right?
Yeah.
So if you have the access of the younger generation and India is a youth country, you would be obviously getting it to the private sectors as well. So I don't think so that you should lose this opportunity. This is one thing, you should grab it and keep it. But yeah, last thing, Kevin, what is this future now? Like, what is the future? What are you guys working around in 1-2 years? How is going to happen? Like, right now it's just 8 grades. right? Certificates and stuff about the education certificate. In future, how is gonna LegitDoc be? And like, how will I as a person will be interacting to it? Obviously, you guys are providing solutions for B2B, but what's gonna be the impact for me as a normal person?
Yeah, see, our vision is to be the go-to platform to, and transform ourselves to the verification layer. So if you say Paytm karo, what do you mean? You verify, you pay, right? So LegitDoc karo should be verified. So our aim is to slowly transition into a platform where any kind of, see, for example, now everything is in siloed, right? You go to a bank, or you go to a, let's say you go to a hospital, or even you take a room, right, in OYO or something like that. You get some kind of invoice. You go to your company again, they kind of verify it, they paid. So there is no single layer where everybody can issue and verify at a single place. Everyone had siloed. So we want to be that layer. So that is our aim, to become slowly transform into a platform. That is one. And I mean, it's a mixture of all, right? So for example, once you become a platform, then as I told you, we can become the bridge between Web 2 and Web 3. We want to be that bridge where people can come and build a lot of services on top of it. So that is one track that we are going. And we so that is a LegitDoc track. So apart from that, we have kind of immersed ourselves. We are working with one team from US, like amazing guys, take care of the permission blockchain layer, because that's where a lot of enterprises, there are some specific use cases that have a lot of value. So we are working on enterprise blockchain layers as well. Initially, I kind of dismissed it, but later I saw the value in it, that, okay, we are doing something there. And thirdly, this is a side project that we have kind of taken up, that we want to do something in the community token space as well. And recently we started talking with few people to, kind of develop these solutions for them. Yeah, that's what. And I do not know what's going to happen in 2 years, at least in my previous, initially when I started out, I started thinking that, okay, this is going to be. So in your startup journey, as again, you have also kind of started on your own. You have to pivot, right? And you come across unexpected things and your entire direction will change. So for the time being, this is what I have in mind, but maybe, my direction
is going to change. Like, thank you so much for doing this, Kevin. It's like, I know it's super difficult for you to explain every Tom, Dick and Harry about the basics, but you have to do it. Like in the beginning, that's your journey. And I know you need so much of patience around you, and it's your startup journey. So, you don't have time for these things, because there's this another battle you have to fight. No, man, thank you so much for doing this, and kudos to LegitDoc.